My name is Asitonka Adri Abba, and
channel is called Asi Darling because I'm such a darling.
Infertility in Nigeria is one of the topics that is talked about in hushed tones. Nobody wants to talk about it, nobody wants to ask questions. And it is, by statistics, we know that one in every eight couple is struggling with infertility. A lot of women, a lot of men are depressed because of infertility. Homes have been broken because of infertility. I had the opportunity to speak with the doctor, Dr. Dare, at Nisa Prime Fertility Center here in the city of Port Harcourt. Good news is the doctor was able to answer every single question that was sent across. So I want to appreciate everybody that took time to send questions via DM from Facebook to Instagram and here on YouTube. So we'll be speaking with the doctor. If you want to know the primary causes of infertility in Nigeria, the possible solutions for male and for the female, please share this video, click the subscribe button. If you're new here, consider subscribing, it's totally free. Click the notification bell. Remember, this is not just for couples that are probably, you might be single now, but this knowledge is important for you because you have a friend, you have a family member that will need this knowledge. Remember to share this video and give it a thumbs up. So you'll be hearing from the doctor now.
Doctor Adebetu Oluwadare, I'm a consultant, obstetrician and gynecologist, and with subspecialty training in IVF, that's treatment of infertile couple. The issue of infertility in Nigeria is not single out in the whole world. Okay. Infertility is an issue that cut across the whole world. Now, the only difference, the differences that occur from different parts of the world is in some parts, infertility is actually as a result of what they want. Take for instance, you go to the developed world, in the US and co, you have couples after getting married, they don't, it's by choice, they don't want to get pregnant, or those who don't want babies. Now when you come to this side of the world, that is not common with us. What we have most of the time is infertility that is due to lifestyle. Lifestyle in the sense that in this part of the world, people egg-seeking behavior is very poor. So when people have infection, when there is any problem, they don't go to hospital, they rather go to places where they buy drugs, and they end up having most of their infections poorly treated or with subclinical cure. So this infection will now fail and continue to fester until damages the reproductive organ. So in this part of the world, what we have is mostly as a result of infections that has occurred in the past. So infertility is something that cut across every part of the world, but the cause in different parts of the world now vary from one part to the other. The causes now, we talk about the 30% that is due to the woman problem as well with the reproductive tract of the woman, while another 30% is due to the man. Then there is this the 20% that is due to the combined problem of the couple, why 20% remain unknown.
Okay, that's the unexplained.
That's the one that we say unexplained. Unexplained now vary from one part of the world to the other. For the 20% we don't know, we have investigated the man and we have investigated the woman based on the availability of equipment in this part of the world, and all of the two of them seems to be okay. So okay, for couples like that, we put them under unexplained infertility. Now for the combined factor, husband and wife, take for instance, the husband and wife that are not living together. Okay. Husband is in one country, the wife is in another country, or husband is working in another state, the wife is working elsewhere. They probably maybe see once in a month or once in 2 months. And if you look at the physiology of a woman can only get pregnant for 24 hours, just one day, within a month. So that 24 hours is lost next month.
Okay.
So that's the problem of the two of them combined. That's
combined
one reason. Now, if you're talking about the female causes now, there are those that are due to the abnormality in the development of the woman while she was developing her mother. Those are the congenital ones.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the acquired ones. Earlier on, I talked about the acquired ones, which is more predominant in our environment.
Mm-hmm.
Then that does not mean the congenital ones are not there. When you talk about congenital, these are the problems that the woman was born with.
Okay.
Talk about abnormality along the female reproductive tract, right from the vagina, the entrance of the womb cervix, the womb itself, the tubes, the ovaries, and some other hormonal disorder. While for the man, while on the other hand, you have acquired causes like sexually transmitted infections that was poorly treated, leading to chronic PID. Now, this infection can destroy the tube, destroy the endometrial lining, cause some degree of cervical stenosis, cause a problem pelvic lavatory disease that even make act of coitus, that sexual intercourse, painful or difficult. So these are some of the acquired causes on the back of the woman. Now for the man, the same thing. There are some that are congenital and there are some that are acquired. Now when you look at the male causes, the one that is predominant is when they talk about low sperm counts. Now low sperm counts, that's when the sperm parameters are very poor, or as you spermia, when the man is not producing sperm at all. There are some of these conditions that are due to congenital causes, the problems that the man was born with. Then there are some that are due to acquired causes. So like when a man suffers from obstructive vasospermia, that's the passage through which the cells, the sperm cells should pass through, is blocked, probably as a result of previous sexually transmitted infections. Then there are some that their own vasospermia is due to non-production, they are not producing sperm cells at all. So these are problems that can cause them. There are many.
Okay, sorry to interrupt your viewing. I'm here again to tell you that the next segment after the doctor speaks, the second video is going to be about native. A lot of people had a lot of questions about native medicines and native massages and womb setting and all those alternative medicine. That's how they have these questions about how the native medicines work with infertility. So the doctor was able to answer that. Remember to subscribe and click that notification bell so you do not miss when I drop that video. Continue to listen to the doctor.
Thank you so much. Questions we got is, when can a couple be worried?
Yeah, we usually advise them to... You see, the issue is the success rate. When it comes to a normal man, a normal woman, you put 10 different couples like that in different rooms throughout the month. The only thing you do is feed them and lock them up in the room. They eat, they have sex. Conception rate is 20% nationally. The meaning of that is people that will go away from such confinement with pregnancy, just 2 out of 10. Others, they get pregnant and the pregnancy will go down with the next month's flow when they are not even aware they are pregnant, because human reproduction is very wasteful. Now, when should a couple, when should they be worried? Now, we talk about 12 months of unprotected sexual intercourse, no use of any contraception, 12 months, provided the woman is below the age of 35. That's when we make that means of infertility.
Okay.
If the woman is below the age of 35 and she has been having protected sexual intercourse for the last 12 months, because we know that more than 80% of newly wedded normal man, normal woman will achieve conception within the first 10 months of their staying together.
So you're saying like below 35 is 12 months?
Below 35, 12 months, if there's no identifiable problem.
Okay.
If there has been an identifiable problem previously, take for instance, the man has been diagnosed of PCOS, or the man has been diagnosed of some other condition, we can start the investigation 6 months. But if the woman is above 35, we don't start the investigation until 12 months. If the man is above 35, we start the investigation 6 months.
Okay.
But those below 35, until 12 months.
Until 12 months.
If there is no identifiable previously diagnosed problem.
I wanted to ask, I got this question. So what are the basic tests they should take before coming to you that will help your analysis so that it's not like they're in a hurry?
Yeah, the usual is in this part of the world where finance is a problem, financial issue is something to consider. We usually advise they come to the hospital first before they embark on taking any test. Come first, so that we can tailor kind of test you are going to do to the perceived problem, so you're just wasting money taking unnecessary tests.
Oh, that's a good one. So when it comes to infertility in general, for this particular segment, this is like the last question there, what are the basic, you've talked of the PCOS, whether for male and female, obstructive azoospermia, for the ladies to block tubes and the rest. what are the available treatments or the available solutions right now that people can start considering?
For it depends, like I said, it depends on the identified cause of the infertility. Once we identify the cause, then we need to treat the cause. We'll start from people with low sperm counts. It depends on how poor the sperm parameters are. If it's just mildly poor, we can advise them on time intercourse so that the man will make up for the mild deficiency in the deficiencies in the sperm parameters with frequency of the intercourse.
Okay.
So that the man can make up for that. For those that their own will not be able to do natural conception, we can advise them on ovarian stimulation. Collect the sperm, concentrate it, and do what we call IUI, that's intrauterine sperm injection. Then for those that the sperm parameters are very poor, we advise them to do probably go for IVF. Now for women with PCOS, it's not difficult to treat PCOS. It depends on what the woman wants. PCOS usually manifests as evidence of hyperandrogenism, in which the woman starts to grow here like a man, or the voice is becoming deep like that of a man, and then the woman may not be menstruating regularly, then it may be difficult for them to conceive. These are the problems that usually occur with PCOS. So it depends on what she wants. If she wants to be menstruating regularly, as in a woman who probably is not married yet, the treatment is there. If she wants to get pregnant, the treatment is there. So PCOS is not something to worry about.
Okay, so wow, thank you so much. So we are done with this first segment.
Thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned a lot from this first segment. Remember to ask all your questions down below. The doctor will be able to answer your questions, every question you have. We answer all our comments, and I'll be sure to send your comments or your questions straight to the doctor. If you live outside Port Harcourt and you have questions, please write in the comment section below. I remain your girl Acid Darling, signing out. I put this post on Facebook telling people not to badmouth or not to speak against or not to be like womb watchers for people that are struggling with infertility. A lot of people dropped a lot of comments about it. And I know that people are still, people are still confused about what should I tell my friend. My friend is struggling with infertility. Should I go to her house with my kids? Should I tell her about my baby shower? Should I tell her I just got pregnant again? How will she feel? And all these many questions you have to ask. I will do you a favor. I'm going to make sure I do a collaboration or a sit down with somebody that struggled with infertility and has come out. So I'm also going to be getting questions and comments that people have heard over the years and they are hot about. People that are still undergoing infertility issues, I'm going to get those questions and those comments, and so that you hear what they don't want you to say. Sometimes it's not enough for just me or just a few people. So that's why I want it to be a collaboration. I want different people to write different things. Write it, send me as a DM. What did they tell you that you do not like? You will be surprised. 80% of these remarks come from fellow women, and that is just alarming. So we want to do better as a society. Make sure to send those comments. I'm going to be doing that collaboration very soon. I'll try as much as possible to reach out to the other person so that we do a sit down. I want you, both male and female, please, there are certain things you do not say. Tomorrow, when they say we are the future generation, you're going to be the next mother-in-law. You're going to be the next father-in-law, the next elder. So if you do not want to learn and hear the doctor out or hear us out when we talk about this, tomorrow when you're faced with this similar issue in your immediate family, you have to know how to handle it, okay? So very important, leave a comment down below. I answer all my comments. Sometimes people suffer miscarriages, late miscarriages, pain, and their stomach is still big. Poking their stomach and rubbing it and saying it has a don't enter is wrong. There is no two ways. It is wrong. I know you want to ask, oh, what if the person is like my friend or my paddy? If the person was not the second person you told about your pregnancy after your husband and family, the person is not your paddy. If that person found out you were pregnant with the day you gave birth, you do not have the right to ask that person anything about the person's stomach. Let us repeat it again. If this person you say is your friend found out about your pregnancy the day you gave birth, or found out about your pregnancy by accident by the 4th, 7th, 8th month when the person saw you around, you do not need to comment about their stomach, their uterus, their womb, or anything. If you agree with this statement, leave a comment down below. It is important we say it. Somebody has to say it. So that's why I'm here. I'll take all the hits. I'll take everything you need to say. I had my own journey, even if it was for a sprinkle of a time. I know what I heard now. So me, I will share it. I will share. In fact, I remember telling you guys I'm going to share the worst things. Like, there are the light ones. So then there's the one that will make you say, Father, what did I do? It is funny now because it's after the victory, but there are people that are still going through it and they are crying every night. Be the guy or be the lady that does not send a couple to bed in tears because of your remarks. You don't enter, you don't score the goal, you they don't know. I be madam, no, they do well. Different remarks, it's painful. I know you say you don't mean it that way. I know you want to say, oh, it's a normal thing, guy. It is not. There are many people that are hot. There are many people that are sincerely bitter from comments like that. So please, we can do better. Remember, the doctor, the next vlog is going to be about native medicine. Should we do native? People that want to go for womb setting, they say, oh, your womb is at the back. Your womb is facing this side. You need to turn the womb to face this side. Oh, no, 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 no. We will hear from the doctor if all those things are real. So thank you so much for watching. My name is Asitonka Agri Abba, and this channel is called Asidarling because I'm such a darling.